Hello friends, welcome to yet another intriguing edition of Biology Made Easy. Today I'll be bringing you a very ecstatic topic known as the glycolysis, and I'll be specifically talking about the EMP version, that is the Embden Meyerhof Parnas Pathway of the glycolysis. It differs from the end-to-end diuretic pathway in the sense that in the ED pathway or end-to-end diuretic pathway, we have only a net production of one ATP molecule and one NADH molecule, whereas in the EMP version of glycolysis, we have a net production of two ATP molecules and two NADH molecules. The glycolysis, the EMP pathway, is one of the most conserved pathways, that is, it occurs in almost all the prokaryotes and in the eukaryotic system, just like it has been shown in this whiteboard by using all these steps and all these specific enzymes. Now, let's get down to business. When we start with the glycolytic process, this process is divided mainly into two parts. Number one is the preparatory phase, number two is the payoff phase. In the specific phase known as the preparatory phase, what happens is a glucose molecule, which is the 6-carbon molecule, which is one of the primary sources of energy for any kind of cell, is broken down, and in its breakage, in its dissociation or breakdown, what happens is two ATP molecules are used up. The usage of two ATP molecules are, they do take place, and two ADP molecules are, and two PI molecules are released, thereby energy is used up to form glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate molecule eventually. And then in the payoff phase, the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate molecule is the main molecule which is oxidized ultimately into releasing or into synthesizing or giving off a 3-carbon molecule known as the pyruvic acid or pyruvate. In this very process, 4 ATPs are generated or synthesized. Thereby, the net ATP generation in the glycolytic process becomes 2, and 2 NADH molecules are also produced by using the 2 NAD plus molecules. Now let's get down to business about the molecular detail. In glycolysis, what happens is the glucose molecule, this entire reaction occurs in the cytosol or cytoplasm. The glycolytic molecules, number one is the glucose, and all these enzymes are all known as soluble enzymes present in the cytosol only. Now glucose is phosphorylated by a specific enzyme known as hexokinase. We have hexokinase 1, 2, 3 and 4. So I'll be dealing about those specific hexokinases and glute transporters in my later videos. Now glucose is phosphorylated at its 6th position by the enzyme hexokinase. Kinase means which transfers the phosphate group. And it, where does it get its phosphate group from, right? So the substrate is ATP. It takes the gamma phosphate group, the gamma phosphate out, and it causes the addition or formation of the phosphoanhydride bond here. Is the glucose 6-phosphate bond. Now, glucose 6-phosphate is formed, that is, glucose is phosphorylated at its 6th carbon and ATP plus PI is released. Here the major thing is Mg2 plus is the major cofactor. What happens is Mg2 plus shields the negative charges present on the phosphoryl group, thereby allowing the hexokinase, right, to cause the attack via the OH group of the nucleophile of the nucleophilic attack. So Mg2 plus shields the phosphate group, and thereby what happens is glucose has got the OH group. So the OH group can cause nucleophilic attack via the enzyme hexokinase. Now forming the glucose 6-phosphate. Now glucose 6-phosphate is converted to fructose 6-phosphate, and you could notice here that this is an irreversible reaction. This is a reversible reaction, means this reaction has got a del G of negative, right? Because it's caused by kinase, and that's a mostly an irreversible process because the del G or the Gibbs free energy change is negative. Here the Gibbs free energy change is positive because it's just an isomerization reaction which takes place by the enzyme. Isomerase glucose 6-phosphate is converted into its one of its isomers known as fructose 6-phosphate. Now the third step is one of the most crucial step in my perspective. Why? Because it's known as the rate limiting step. Here the glucose 6-phosphate or fructose 6-phosphate can also diverge or can also take the path of hexose monophosphate shunt pathway or any other glycolytic, or any other pathway other than glycolysis. But what happens is after we synthesize or after fructose 1,6-bisphosphate gets synthesized in the cytoplasm or the cytosol, then this becomes committed towards completion of this entire process. Then it will end up after the completion of the pyruvate, thereby completing or finishing up the entire glycolytic process. That's known as the committed step. So the first committed step towards glycolysis is the formation of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. And that occurs by the enzyme phosphofructokinase 1, There is one more enzyme known as phosphofructokinase 2, which converts fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 2,6-bisphosphate, catalyzing the conversion of the fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 2,6-bisphosphate, means transferring the phosphate group from at the second carbon of the fructose 6-phosphate. But this one, phosphofructokinase 1, catalyzes the conversion of fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, means it uses ATP as the substrate, Mg2+ as the cofactor again, and it's an irreversible process, means the del G has to be negative, it's a kinase enzyme. Then what happens is, it transfers the phosphate group from the gamma phosphate ATP to the first position of the fructose carbon, thereby producing fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and you got to be very, very careful while naming it, because biphosphate means at the same carbon position you add more than one phosphate, two phosphates, whereas bisphosphate means one phosphate is at the first carbon, another phosphate is already present at the sixth carbon, therefore it is known as fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Then we have got something known as enzyme aldolase, which causes aldol condensation. You might have come across it in the organic chemistry. Aldol condensation will break down this 6 carbon fructose 1,6-bisphosphate into 3 carbon each, dihydroxyacetone phosphate plus glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Now these two specific compounds, what happens is, this dihydroxyacetone phosphate will be converted via isomerase into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, right? Thereby you will be getting 2 glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And aldolases are of two types, class 1 and class 2. The class 1 aldolases are present in all the plants and animals, and it uses a CYP base intermediate. Whereas class 2 doesn't use a CYP base intermediate, it uses zinc ion, and it's present in fungi and bacteria. Now we enter the payoff phase. Now the real game begins. Any pathway in the biochemistry in our body doesn't happen just because to use the ATP. It has to have a specific function or a specific goal, that is to produce ATP or to produce reducing equivalents. Now here we have already used two ATPs. Now what you will see here, what you will be able to comprehend is that we will be generating four ATPs in this payoff phase. That's why the name is payoff. It will pay you something. Now glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. I was going through NCERT books and I found that there are pretty huge errors. In the NCERT book I saw, what I came across was, this PI is absent, and number two, the entire glycolytic process yields zero ATPs, because they have shown two ATP here, two ATP here, and this two things, that is the two compounds are formed. There is also quite huge errors here. So let me correct you. For JRF and for PMT, this is the extremely correct pathway taken from Wirt and Wirt. You can check Albert Lellinger's book. You can check any biochemistry book, right? Harper's Biochemistry. Then you will find this pathway to be precise as per the current research. So the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, what happens is, there is a specific enzyme again known as dehydrogenase, causes the oxidation of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Now glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. You can see that now two glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate molecules are present, one here and one after the isomerization of this, because the dihydroxyacetone phosphate just cannot take part in glycolysis. It has to be converted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So now we have got two glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, and you always have to check the stoichiometry. 6 carbon, 3 into 2, 6 carbon. So the carbon number must always be equal. Or if it is going out, you must show where one of the carbons or two of the carbons have gone out. So always keep in mind, in any kind of biochemical process, the stoichiometry has to be taken care of very, very precisely. So since it's a catabolic process, that is the breakdown process or the oxidation process, now glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized, and if it is oxidized, something has to be reduced, because it's a redox reaction, otherwise the system would be pretty unstable with the concomitant release of free electrons. Thereby oxidation is supported by concomitant reduction, that is the reduction of NAD plus into NADH and production of H plus ions. Now the thing in question, the best question here is, the concentration of NAD plus is, you can say, less than 10 to the power minus 5 mole in the cytoplasm. So how does it get replenished? So that I'll be talking about in my next video, when I'll be talking in depth about the regulation of glycolysis. Now here NADH is formed, NAD plus is used up, Now, this is a process where an inorganic phosphate is used up, not from ATP, but from the pool of inorganic phosphate in the cytosol, number one. Number two is, in this very process, in this dehydrogenation or dehydrogenase enzyme catalyzed process, what happens is, the formation, the aldehyde group in glyceraldehyde, 3-phosphate, is oxidized, but not to a carboxyl group, but to a carboxylic acid anhydride with phosphoric acid. That is the formation of acyl phosphate, which has a negative del G of minus 49.3 kilojoule per mole, which is very, very high, you can say, in the negative sense. So that means that this specific glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate reaction, that is the acyl phosphate reaction, will form what is called acyl phosphate group, and that will be attacked by the inorganic PI to form eventually the 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate molecule, right? Then this 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate molecule, and you can see this reaction is again reversible in nature because the total del G change is positive. And then this 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate molecule, very, very important step, very significant step here, is converted to 3-phosphoglycerate. Mg2+ is the cofactor, kinase is again the enzyme. And since it is there are two molecules, then 2-ATP, 2-ADP plus the first PI from two molecules will attach to each ADP and give you and get to the formation of 2-ATP molecules. So this is the first step where you are able to watch, where we are able to see or visualize the formation of ATP. And this is known as substrate level phosphorylation. It differs from respiratory level phosphorylation in the sense that this occurs due to direct transfer of phosphate group from one substrate to the other. And it occurs by the usage of the soluble enzymes, not the transmembrane attached enzymes and the proton gradient, right, which occurs in the electron transport chain and the F1, F0 ATPase. So, it's the first step of substrate level phosphorylation here. But you can see that I have put a double arrow, that is, it's a reversible process. Even though the del G is negative, this kinase enzyme is very special. This kinase enzyme is able to catalyze the reverse reaction also in case of gluconeogenesis. That's why I put especially this double arrow here, causing the reversible sign. But here, in this case, the del G is negative and it proceeds forward in the forward direction. Now, this 3-phosphoglycerate is converted into 2-phosphoglycerate, meaning that the specific phosphate at the third position of phosphoglycerate is transferred to the second position of phosphoglycerate by the enzyme phosphoglucomutase or simply a mutase, and again using Mg2+ as the cofactor, right? In case of this dehydrogenase, the main enzyme or the main amino acid residue is cysteine, the SH group or the sulfur group of cysteine. Here in mutase, the main active site contains histidine, right? What happens is the mutase contains the, you can say, phosphate group already along with it at the second position. And it will transfer it to the, you can say, second position, that phosphate group, 2,3-phosphoglycerate, forming 2,3-phosphoglycerate, or you can say 2,3-BPG, you can say 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate, because 2 and 3 are the different phosphates. So 2,3-bisphosphoglycerates, and then this 3-phosphoglycerate, the phosphate at the third position, would be broken down and transferred to the second position of mutase again. And this cycle keeps on repeating. That's a very intriguing and interesting concept here. The mutase already has got phosphate at the second carbon there. And this histidine is, it plays a very crucial role at the active site of this enzyme mutase. Now, when you have got two phosphoglycerate molecules, right? Now, what would happen is, here you can say, since I put two, so in this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, you can add two here, you can add two here, and you can add two here. So it will be 2-NAD+, 2-NADH, and 2-H+. Now, we have got 2-phosphoglycerate. Now the specific enzyme that will come next in this reversible reaction, because in this reaction the del G would be positive, this reaction also del G would be positive, the previous reaction caused by the or catalyzed by the enzyme mutase. So now 2-phosphoglycerate would be converted into two molecules of phosphoenol pyruvate by the specific enzyme enolase, which again uses the magnesium as the cofactor, the mineral, and it takes out, you can say it's kind of a 2H2O taking out reaction, means it will cause dehydration, that is 2H2O would be taken out. Why does it happen? The answer is here. The del G naught of hydrolysis, that is the phosphate group release capability, is minus 17.6 kilojoule per mole when it comes to 2-phosphoglycerate. But when it comes to phosphoenol pyruvate, the del G naught hydrolysis, that is the phosphate group losing capability, phosphate group hydrolysis capability, goes till minus 61.9 kilojoule per mole. So this is the very important reason, and this is the only reason why the evolution has caused the synthesis of enolase and thereby phosphoglycerate. This is known as 2-phosphoglycerate is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate, and then phosphoenol pyruvate is contracted by another enzyme known as pyruvate kinase, or simply another type of kinase, causing the phosphate group 2-phosphate. So 2-ATP plus 2-PI would be released. They will serve as the substrate. Again, substrate level phosphorylation 2. Substrate level phosphorylation 1 occurred here when 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate was converted to 3-phosphoglycerate. Here, the second event of substrate level phosphorylation would take place, and thereby you will be getting 2-pyruvate molecules, or 2-pyruvic acid molecules. And the entire del G naught of this process, again, it's a positive arrow, a reversible process, del G naught would be negative 31.4. kilojoule per mole, right? So why 31.4? You can subtract 31.4 from 61.9. What you will get is 30.5. So minus 30.5 kilojoule per mole is used up to cause the addition of phosphoanhydride bond into this pyruvate group, not into this pyruvate group, but into this ADP, right? So thereby forming ATP, that is the formation of gamma phosphate, that is the addition of phosphoanhydride bond to the ADP, therefore ATP could be formed again. So for this very process, minus 30.5 kilojoule per mole is used up to cause the catalysis or addition of the gamma phosphate to the ADP, thereby converting ADP to ATP, right? So the entire process has a remaining del G naught of minus 31.4 kilojoule per mole. And this is the equation, the ultimate equation of glycolysis. 1 glucose molecules plus 2 ATP plus 2 NAD plus 4 ADP plus 2 PI would yield 2 pyruvate molecules, as you can see here. You can see again 2 ADP molecules, 2 H plus, 4 ATP molecules and 2 H2O. So the net ATP, what you are getting is 2. How? 4 ATP has been produced here. 2 ATP was used up here. So the net ATP molecule, what you are getting is 4, because 4 ATP has been produced, 2 ATP has been used up. So just subtract the ATP produced in the payoff phase and the ATP produced in the preparatory phase. So what you will get is a net ATP production of 2 ATPs. And this pyruvate molecule is also a very interesting and intriguing process, the formation of this pyruvate molecule. You can see a single arrow, number one, because it's a irreversible process. Now how? First of all, the pyruvate molecule produced is in its enol form. Then what happens? Non-enzymatic tautomerization takes place, which converts the pyruvate molecule into its keto form, which is the most stable form of the pyruvate molecule. Thereby, it also contributes towards the minus 31.4 kilojoule per mole of del G naught. That is the driving force towards this formation of pyruvate being an irreversible process. So that's about it. That's the conceptual prowess. You need to understand the EMP version of the glycolytic pathway. If you have had any troubles in the comprehension of this process, do not hesitate to post your queries in the comment section below. If you found the content relevant, then kindly like my video and also hit the subscribe button and subscribe to my channel, Biology Made Easy. Thanks a lot. See you soon.